knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
Continuing through the clade Ecdysozoa, we reach phylum Nematomorpha, also commonly known as the horsehair worms. This name is derived from the old superstition that worms could arise from horse hairs that happened to fall into water. They are also known as hair worms or Gordian worms and do somewhat resemble hairs from a horse's tail. They were historically included within phylum Nematoda because the two clades both have a cuticle, epidermal nerve cords, strictly longitudinal muscles, and a similar nervous system. In fact, the phylum name, Nematomorpha, roughly means nematode in morphology, though they have been considered their own phylum since the late 1800s. As a phylum, they are comprised entirely of parasitoids. There are no entirely free-living horsehair worms described anywhere in the world. They are split into two classes, Nectonematoida and Gordioidea. The five species of Nectonematoida are entirely marine-dwelling and as larvae exclusively parasitize at least 28 host species of decapod crustaceans, including hermit crabs and shrimp. Members of Gordioidea are parasites of terrestrial arthropods, most notably crickets, mantises, and cockroaches, and free-living in freshwater as reproductive adults. Their class name and the common name of Gordian worms in general is a reference to the legendary Gordian knot, due to the worm's aptitude for coiling themselves up into tight balls, which resemble knots, especially when mating. At present, there are about 350 described species of terrestrial or freshwater horsehair worms, though some estimates place the total species count at over 2,000. That means there are likely quite a few more of these cryptic and difficult-to-study animals to be discovered, and their total species count has been climbing annually since their discovery. In order to explore them in some depth, we will go over their form and function, life cycle, and finally, a short note on pseudoparasitism. Horsehair worms are generally extremely long and slender. Most are just 0.5 to 3 millimeters in diameter, and adults of some species can reach a length of 100 millimeters, while others can reach lengths of 1 to 2 meters or more. As adults, their anterior end is generally rounded, and their posterior end terminates in 2 to 3 caudal lobes, which is indicative of sex. Males generally have 2 caudal lobes, while females have 3. Like the nematodes, they possess an external cuticle without cilia and a nerve ring near the anterior end of the animal, and a ventral nerve cord running along the body. They have no excretory, respiratory, or circulatory systems, and their digestive system appears to be entirely vestigial. Since they live most of their lives as parasites, they instead rely on their host's ability to respire, excrete waste, and circulate nutrients. Like many flatworm parasites, they simply absorb nutrients and oxygen across their body walls and release waste and carbon dioxide into their hosts. Larvae have rings of cuticular hooks and terminal stylets that are believed to be used to enter the hosts. Once inside the host, the larvae live inside the arthropod's hemocell, which is a body cavity that contains fluid where they absorb nutrients and mature into adults. The life cycle of some nematomorphins has been studied in great detail, while the life history of others, most notably the marine species, is almost entirely unknown. The best known nematomorph life cycles are those of genus Gordius. Like all nematomorphs, adults of genus Gordius are free-living as adults and obligate parasites as juveniles. They are dioecious as adults, meaning male or female, and when two adults of opposite sex find one another, they form densely coiled Gordian knots, and the male internally fertilizes the female by passing sperm from his cloaca, which is both his anus and male reproductive organ, into hers. The female lays fertilized eggs in gelatinous masses that hatch into larvae which enter into their peritonic host. This host is often the larval form of an aquatic insect. In this example, it is a midge larva. In order to infect their terrestrial hosts, the aquatic larvae need a peritonic host, or one in which the parasite does not mature, but is necessary to the parasite's life cycle. Interestingly, the nematomorph parasite can survive its host's metamorphosis into the terrestrial environment. The parasites do so by forming a cyst, a toughened mass within the host's body. If the peritonic host is unfortunate enough to be consumed by an opportunistic insect, like a cricket, mantis, or cockroach, the cyst breaks open inside the final host's body, and the emerging juvenile seeks refuge within the final host's hemocoele, where it goes through a great deal of morphogenesis to transition from a feeding larva into a non-feeding adult. They then cause their host to seek water and often drown itself, thus returning the nematomorph to the freshwater environment. The nematomorph will not emerge unless its host is able to find water. Some hosts can carry a great deal of horsehair worms. There are occasional reports of horsehair worms infecting vertebrates, but many of these reports are now contested as cases of pseudoparasitism. Pseudoparasitism, or false parasitism, often occurs when an infected host is consumed by another predator and the parasite emerges. There are numerous accounts of horsehair worms emerging from frogs and fish, but closer inspection of more recent studies has found that the vertebrates had recently consumed an infected host and the nematomorph was merely escaping. Though there are a few cases of potential human infection, it is very possible those infections were also cases of pseudoparasitism, since there are no described nematomorphs that target humans. And that's it for the horsehair worms and nematoida in general. Let's move forward and examine Panarthropoda next.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.